Amen. Please do take your seats. Good evening. Good to see you all this evening. We're carrying on, as we have been for the last couple of months actually now, a series called Dare to Believe. We've been working our way through the Bible, stopping off at different characters who've demonstrated amazing faith in God. Last week, we looked at Hannah, a woman who had born to her this miracle child of Samuel. And where we pick up again this evening is decades later. That baby, Samuel, has grown up. He's become the leader of the nation of Israel, effectively. He's ruled, and now in his old age, or just before this chapter, in his old age, the people of Israel asked for a king. And so the king they got was a man called Saul. You probably know about Saul. Saul was a complete disaster, really, of a king. He had a few bright spots at the start, but everything went downhill. And just before the passage that Emily read to us a moment ago, God has rejected Saul as his king. He said no to him. Not rejected him as a person, but as a king, he has no future with God. And this has torn Samuel apart. Samuel is an old man now, and he's completely devastated by this. You can imagine Samuel, who part of his life's work has been to get Saul to be king, to secure the leadership of the nation, and it's all unraveled. Samuel, who cares about this bloke, he really loves Saul. And he's seeing him destroying his life in this downward spiral, and it tears him up. Samuel, who loves the nation, who cares about God's kingdom and God's glory, and is concerned for what's going to happen, and he's terrified for the future. We can imagine the emotions of this old prophet who's been through an awful lot as he looks on and sees this big question mark over the nation that he cares about. So let's have a look at this passage and see what exactly happens next. If you've got a Bible with you, open it up to 1 Samuel 16. We're going to start at verse 1 where the reading began. If you've got a phone or something, you can follow it on. That would be good. Or look at your neighbor, see whether they've got a Bible you can peek at as we go along. But it starts off chapter 16, verse 1. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you mourn for Saul since I've rejected him as king over Israel?" That sense of mourning that we just began to explore. Samuel must have been feeling such despair at this moment. But God goes on. "Fill your horn with oil and be on your way. I'm sending you to Jesse of Bethlehem. I have chosen one of his sons to be king." Suddenly in this passage, it's as if the dawn has kind of sprung. The sun has risen. In this dark moment, God offers hope. Whatever's gone on before, God now has chosen a king, has chosen his king. And Samuel, in this maybe this last move of his life, you know, so perhaps if you're older, you're wondering, will this be my last year? Will this be my last significant thing I do? Will this be the last kind of chapter in my life? I know people who reach the twilight years of life, they ask those kinds of questions. And Samuel would probably be asking those kind of questions. When Saul was rejected by God, is that it? Will that be what I'm known for, the legacy I leave? But God says there's one more chapter, at least. Go to Bethlehem. Go to the family of Jesse. I've chosen a king. So, look at verse 2. Samuel, after the elation, I guess, that he would have got there, he realizes there's a bit of a problem here. Samuel says, "How can I go? If Saul hears about it, he will kill me." Saul had already shown himself to be slightly unhinged. He was a slightly crazy character. You read the rest of the book, you realize he's completely nuts, paranoid, this crazy king. And so Samuel isn't overstating it. There is a good chance he will lose his life if Saul finds out about this, humanly speaking at least. And so Samuel is a little bit worried. After the excitement of hearing God's king is on the way, he's worried about his part in it. He'd rather maybe have nothing to do with it if he's going to lose his life. But God explains what the plan is going to be. "Take a heifer." That's always good news, isn't it? "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice and I'll show you what to do. You are to anoint for me the one I indicate." So go with a pretext. Go and give a sacrifice. Go and give the sacrifice. But while you're there, anoint for me a king. It's a good plan. So Samuel did what the Lord said. This is verse 4. "When he arrived at Bethlehem, the elders of the town trembled when they met him. They asked, 'Do you come in peace?'" I was wondering as I was looking through this during the week, why they trembled? Partly it's probably because Samuel has been the leader of the people for up until the point when Saul took over. Decades he's been the leader of the country. And I think if any of us met a kind of a national leader, past or present, we'd probably tremble a little bit. And add to that the fact that Samuel was, he has this spiritual dimension to him, doesn't he? He's a prophet. He speaks with God. I mean, that would have been terrifying in and of itself. So there's something there, but the clue maybe that we need to take notice of is there might be a political side to it too. Do you come in peace? I think what they're asking is, are we going to be put in a really awkward position here? Are you rallying support for some kind of revolution, some kind of overthrow of Saul? They already knew there'd been a few skirmishes, or more than that, really, between Samuel and Saul up to this point. Are they going to have to choose between the prophet and the king? I mean, heads are going to roll if that's the situation. They don't want to be involved in this. They'd rather have nothing to do with it. But then Samuel puts them at ease. Samuel replied, "Yes, in peace. I've come to sacrifice to the Lord." Kind of cue the heifer. The heifer comes in. Everyone feels okay. They're all at ease now because, well, apart from the heifer. "Consecrate yourselves and come to the sacrifice with me." Then he consecrated Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they arrived, Samuel saw Eliab. You remember why he's actually come, to pick a king. And he thought to himself, and here you get the sort of internal dialogue of Samuel's head. "Surely the Lord's anointed stands before the Lord." And he sees Eliab. And Eliab is ripped. And Eliab is 6'6". And Eliab can bench press 500 pounds. And he can throw a cricket ball half a mile. He's a monster of a man. But he's also got charm and political savvy. I mean, he is the perfect king. On every front, he scores high. He looks exactly like the kind of king that they need. And so when Samuel sees him, he thinks, "We've got our man, brilliant. Firstborn to Jesse, he's the king we want." And actually what we've got here is just a replay of what happened with Saul. Maybe you know the story of 1 Samuel. What was Saul like? I mean, just flip back in your Bibles if you can to chapter 9 and verse 2. Saul, the son of Kish, we have here. How's he described? Chapter 9, verse 2. "Kish had a son named Saul, as handsome a man as you could, as could be found anywhere in Israel. And he was a head taller than anyone else." So you can imagine his chiseled jaw, his good looks, classic good looks, and he's big and he's strong. It's exactly what you want from a king, don't you? Kind of the guys want to be him, the girls want to be with him, and he's terrifying to any of your enemies. That's the kind of king you want. And so that's exactly what Samuel goes for again. Eliab, perfect. Saul, Mark 2. But, and this is the heart of the verse. You probably, when you heard the reading, this just stands out, this verse. It's kind of illuminated, isn't it, amongst the rest of the chapter. Verse 7. "But the Lord said to Samuel, 'Do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. He's not my king. The Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart.'" It's a simple point, isn't it? The point isn't that if you want to be a good leader, you need to be really ugly. That's not the point that he's trying to make here. He's just, all he's saying is that your outward appearance doesn't really matter. It's inconsequential when it comes to who will be a good king of God's people. It's like whether you, I don't know, like Marmite or where your favorite place is to go on holiday. Those things don't really matter. They have no influence or bearing on the fact of whether you're going to be a good king or not of God's people. And the same thing is true of the outward appearance. Now, God looks inside. God looks to character. God looks to the heart. And this is a wake-up call for Samuel because he was looking to all the wrong things again for the second time. Like the nation had looked to the wrong things when they had Saul chosen as their king. And how disastrous that was. And I think what we see here, in a very simple way, it was put beautifully by an author called Dale Ralph Davis. He says this: sometimes God has to save us from our saviors. Isn't that interesting? Sometimes God has to save us from our saviors because actually the king that we want or the king that we choose isn't always the king that we need. And God realizes that right here. When Samuel is thinking that Eliab would make a fantastic successor to the throne, God realizes that actually they need something very different, a different kind of person. So, in verse 8, let's follow the story down. "Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass in front of Samuel." So he walks around a little bit. But Samuel said, "Nor has the Lord chosen this one." And Jesse made 7 of his sons pass before Samuel. But Samuel said to him, "The Lord has not chosen these." So Jesse asked the obvious question: are these all the sons you have? He's been sent here to find a son of Jesse to be the king, and none of them seem to do the job. God's not happy with any of them. So is there anyone else? Jesse says, "Ah, well, there is the youngest, but he's out with the sheep. You know, you don't want to see him. He's not worth considering." Samuel said, "Send for him. We will not sit down until he arrives." Now, I imagine it would have taken like 10, 15 minutes to get him at the Lord's. And that would have been a really awkward 10 minutes, okay? No one's sitting down, probably no one's talking, everyone's feeling a bit embarrassed, and they're just standing there, twiddling their thumbs, waiting for David to arrive, and it's really awkward, okay? Then David walks in. They sent for him and had him brought in. He was glowing with health and had a fine appearance and handsome features. Then the Lord said, "Rise and anoint him. This is the one." So Samuel took his horn of oil and he anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David. Samuel then went to Ramah. See, just like we'd learnt from God earlier in the chapter, David wasn't the kind of king that everyone was looking for. He didn't necessarily look exactly like a king would look. He was more like a kind of a kid on school holidays working at the farm to earn a bit of money before the start of term than the kingly figure that we see in Eliab. I mean, Eliab looks like he could front an army, doesn't he? David didn't. David wasn't the kind of king you would choose if you were just looking the way that we tend to look. And so the question is, what is going on here? Well, I think in this passage, actually in the whole book, and kind of the whole theme of the king in this book, they've misunderstood what it is that they really, really need. They've misunderstood what it is that they need. You see, they see an immediate need they have, and for a kind of Iron Age Middle Eastern society, probably the immediate need you have is national security. You need to make sure that you have a king who is like a kind of Iron Age version of a Trident missile system, who can blow anyone off the planet. You know, actually, if we turn back to where we were before, to actually chapter 8, I think, this time. Chapter 8, verse 19, and you'll see the kind of king they were looking for. When they insisted on having a king, even against everyone's good, well, Samuel's good advice, this is what they say. Chapter 8, verse 19. But the people refused to listen to Samuel. "No," they said, "we want a king over us. Then we shall be like the other nations, with a king to lead us and to go out before us and fight our battles." That's what they're after. They see an immediate need. They see what they think is their biggest, most pressing need for security, for solid leadership, for someone who can beat everybody up and make sure they don't get into trouble. And so, the obvious choice, the obvious king, the obvious savior, is someone in the shape of Saul or someone in the shape of Eliab. But the truth is that national security, if you want to call it that, isn't their biggest or their deepest need. I actually have a problem which goes far deeper, a problem which is far more rooted in who they are that needs addressing. I'm hoping you kept your finger in chapter 8 because we're going back there now, so apologies if you're going to be flicking around a bit. But chapter 8, verse 7, God uncovers actually what the deeper need is. The kind of background to this is Samuel feels a bit bruised. He's been leading them for decades, and now they're calling out for a king. And he feels a bit upset about this. But God says this to him in verse 7. "Listen to all that the people are saying to you. It is not you they have rejected, but they've rejected me as their king." And that's the heart of it here. The problem for the people of Israel at this point in history is not that they need a big kind of bruiser of a king who can go out and make sure they don't get beaten up on the battlefield. That's not what they need. I mean, that would be useful, but it's not the big problem that they face. The big issue that they face is that they've lost touch with God. They've rejected God. They need to have the covenant God, the creator God, on their side. They need to be in relationship with him. I mean, you read everything that's come before 1 Samuel, and you'll see that national security is no problem for people who are trusting in God. I mean, think about the Red Sea. Think about other stories like that when God takes care of business. They don't have to worry. You read the book of Joshua. You see how God takes care of national security because the bigger things are in place because God's people are trusting their king, their God. When they're in relationship with him, then the other problems that seem to flutter around really do evaporate into thin air. And so the deep problem for them is not to have a kind of big bruiser of a king, but to have a king who will lead them into deeper relationship with God. And that's what they find in David, a king who will lead them into deeper relationship with God. But of course, this pattern is repeated all up and down through history, isn't it? This pattern of people rejecting God, people misdiagnosing what the real problem is, And so people looking to a king, or even, do we want to use the word savior? Looking to a savior that doesn't really answer the problems that they're facing. We see this right up and down through history. And we see it most clearly, maybe passages like the one we looked at this morning, when people had rejected God, when they didn't recognize what their problem really was. They wanted a different kind of savior, and so they miss God's king. They reject God's king. And you think, in our age, I think we're guilty of the same thing. You know, just like any time in history, I think we're guilty of this as a society, rejecting God. And so losing sight of what the real problem is. Now, our problems are not going to look anything like the problems of someone who lives in Iron Age, Middle Eastern kind of cultures. For them, their perceived problem was that their neighbors are going to come and beat them up and kick them out, and they're going to lose their land, and someone's going to steal their flocks. You know, that's the kind of thing which you're worried about then. For us, we live in the first 21st century, and so our problems are very different. Actually, our lifestyle is so much more comfortable. The kind of problems we face, I mean, some people call them first world problems. You heard about this? Anyone seen the little hashtag you get on things? First world problems? I had a little look because they're quite funny. Some of the things that you may be facing today in your cozy Western life. Imagine you go on a trip and forget your phone charger. Sharp intake of breath from some people. Imagine you have to go to the post office to collect a parcel. Imagine that you have a dinner party and you don't get the brie out on time, so it never reaches room temperature. Imagine that your neighbor chooses the same Laura Ashley wallpaper as you. A problem I've faced before. Two Weetabix don't fit properly in your round bowl. So some of them are soggy and some of them are dry. This is one I'm sure many of us will have struggled with, especially in the hot weather. You want to take your laptop outside, but the Wi-Fi doesn't reach. Nasty. Yeah, this is the kind of world we live in. And so our problems aren't about existing and surviving and getting through. You know, our problems are much more petty and silly. And actually what we strive for, the thing which we think we need, is the good life, you know, kind of a comfortable life, an affluent life, health, wealth, kind of beauty, leisure, a nice job that gives us a sense of fulfillment. You know, these are the kind of things we think we ought to have. And so we look to saviors who we think will give us those things. If that is our problem, if the problem is I'm not healthy enough, or I'm not eating well enough, or I'm not got the right kind of job, or I'm not kind of rich enough, then you look to people who you think can solve that problem for you. And so we anoint these kind of high priests of affluence and health and wealth and all those kinds of things, and they look like these kinds of people. I mean, this is the modern-day equivalent of looking to Eliab to solve your kind of little problems. Who's this? Anyone know? Nobody knows? Oh, somebody knows, surely. Joe Wicks, thank you. Joe Wicks, he is lean, apparently, and can get you lean in 15. So if you don't have a washboard stomach, like the one kind of protruding, I struggled, actually, to find a picture where he had his top on. That was the tricky thing, but this is one I found, because I thought it's a church and everything. Anyway, this guy apparently will solve your problem of being unhealthy through diet and exercise. You'll get sorted, okay? How about this? Who's this? Everyone knows. Yeah, that's right. People aspire to this kind of lifestyle, to have a life that is comfortable, where you have a Labrador trotting around your kind of thatched cottage garden and your children frolicking with the grandchildren in the garden. You make a beautiful sponge and have the lovely china in the background there and a massive pearls. Anyway, and your life is just perfect and happy. And if you could be like Mary Berry, then it would all be okay. She is your savior to get you what you need. How about this? Anyone know who this is? Thank you. Deliciously Ella. If you are having dietary problems, or if you just want to live clean and live healthy, then you have the kind of kitchen she has. You make the kind of food she makes. You have the kind of lifestyle she has. And if you're healthy and if you eat right, then your life will be okay. You'll have the good life. How about this guy? Anyone know who this is? Huh? Martin Lewis, the money-saving expert. You know, people follow him with religious zeal. You want to buy a washing machine? Ask this man. You want to get a good tariff for your gas? Ask this man. You're switching your mortgage? Ask him. And your life will be better because you'll have more money in your pocket and you'll have the satisfaction of beating the big six. You know, this kind of guy here, he is like a savior for the modern money-conscious person. Is that everyone? That's everyone. I mean, we could go on and on and on, but whether you're after affluence or whether you're after a good body or whether you're after the kind of perfect, cozy, rural lifestyle that someone might possess, we look to these people as saviors. If we can follow their advice, if we can do what they do, if we can dress how they dress, if we can look like they look, if we can follow them on Instagram and do everything the way that they do it, then our life will be perfect. If we look to these saviors, just like the people back then were looking to Eliab or they looked to Saul, because they think that they will solve their problems, but there's a problem further down the tracks, isn't there? We haven't diagnosed the problem properly. Our problem isn't that we're not using, what is it, dates nectar, wasn't it? That was it, as a sugar supplement. The problem isn't that we don't have the same china or pearls as Mary Berry. The problem isn't that we don't have a washboard stomach like Joe Wicks or whatever else there was up on the screen just a minute ago. You know, these aren't the problems. The problem goes way deeper. And so a bigger savior is required. Now, can I say there's nothing wrong with half of these people? I don't know. I mean, I haven't met them, but they seem like good enough people. I would probably look on Money Saving Expert if I wanted to switch my gas. That would be something I would do. But the thing is, like Eliab, they're not God's savior for his people. You know, Eliab was probably a nice bloke. It's not his fault that he was big and burly and strong and all that kind of stuff. That was just him, yeah? And he probably had a place in God's kingdom, but he wasn't God's savior for his people. And the same with these people. I mean, you want to find a good recipe for a victorious sponge? Ask Mary Berry. But she's not going to be the savior who's going to give your life meaning and purpose and solve all your problems. Neither's Martin Lewis or whoever else is up on the screen. See, the problem goes deeper, doesn't it? The problem isn't just about our kind of first world problems and having this kind of comfortable lifestyle that we imagine for ourselves, this good life that we see on the TV and read about in newspapers and see on Instagram. The problem is sin and death and violence. And we need a savior who can rescue us from sin and death and violence and rebellion and evil and pain. And there's only one savior that I know about who can do that. And so as Christians, and as those maybe here this evening who weren't sure if they're Christians or not, we need to look to him, because the problem is bigger, and so the savior that is required needs to be bigger too. You know, this morning when we were looking at the story in Mark, we were looking at the way that people missed the king. You know, the king was there. He'd arrived in God's capital to take up his place as God's king of God's people. But people didn't see it that way. People refused to follow him. And again here this evening, we've got a case of mistaken identity. People think they know the kind of king they need. But as I said before, often God has to save us from our saviors, because the king that we want is not necessarily the king that we need. The problems of this world are too big for any one individual to solve, apart from Jesus. And so as in a moment we come to the bread and the cup to eat and drink together, let's remember what Jesus did through his death to rescue us from our ultimate problem, to save us from sin, to save us from death, to save us from pain, to save us from ourselves and the mistakes that we make and the foolish decisions that we make, to rescue us, to turn us around, to clean us up, to make us ready for the new creation where none of that will exist. And every time we take this, we do it to remember that he's coming back and that one day our Savior will put things right. We look to him as a king who can meet our deepest needs and does, and all by grace. So please, please, this evening, don't be like Samuel. You know, Samuel's a great guy, but he took a misstep here, didn't he? Thinking that that kind of king, a small, immediate, meets the immediate needs kind of king, is the king that we need. But God had other ideas. God looks deeper, and God has for us a king who is far greater and meets our needs. Have a moment of quiet, just to think and to reflect. Maybe if the band could come up now. And we're going to sing in just a second. And as we do, we're going to distribute out bread and wine. If you want to take part this evening as a Christian, you're very, very welcome to join us, whether you regularly meet here at Lansdowne or not. Please do take a cup and with some bread on top, and we'll eat and drink together. If this evening you're not sure that you are a Christian or you know that you're not, then just let the bread and wine pass by. And just consider some of the things we've been talking about. Maybe look back through the passage and talk to God about what we've been talking about this evening. But as we sing this song in a moment, we'll be distributing the bread and the wine. Let's just pray quietly ourselves now for a moment, and then I'll close in prayer in a second. Father, we want to confess this evening, each of us, that sometimes we look to the wrong kind of saviors. We buy what the media is telling us, that if we just have a healthier life, or if we just have a more affluent life, or if we achieve success, or if we look good, then we'll be happy, then we'll have the good life. But Lord, you know, please teach us again and again that that isn't the answer. That's just a drop in the ocean. That, Lord, what we need is far bigger. We need the new creation that only Jesus can bring. So, Father, please help us to turn from those lesser saviors and turn to your Savior, to turn from those little kings and to turn to your King, Jesus. Father, thank you that he embraces us, he welcomes us, and he promises us all that we need: forgiveness, relationship with you, a coming kingdom, a new creation. Lord, we want to be a part of his kingdom. Help us to look to him. Help us to live for him, we pray.